Fox Talbot, although most people don't know who he is, it seems, was one of the inventors of photography. In 1839, he announced his process to the world just 2 weeks after a Frenchman named Daguerre announced his process. So we celebrate photography here in all of its permutations, everything from the very earliest photography all the way up through digital and even video, as we do here. Most people don't come to Lacock knowing about that. Most people come looking for Harry Potter, or they come looking for a nice big historic home where they can wander around the rooms and see how people lived in the 19th century and earlier. But we like to focus on photography here and bring it back to life.
One of the things that we really wanted to do at Lacock was to bring places to life. So last year there was a fantastic project all about Matilda Talbot inside the Abbey. What we wanted to do this year was to actually encourage people to go out into the grounds. And we thought that an arts project that connected the story of another Talbot member, Fox Talbot, who created the first photographic negative and lived in the Abbey, would be a great way to do it.
I'm Lisa Pettibone. I'm a sculptor working mostly in glass. My work is often focused on natural forces, things that shape the world around us, such as gravity, wind, even visual phenomena that we see. Talbot planted quite a lot of the trees around the garden. Some of them were exotic trees, from specimen trees from other places. So he was a very enthusiastic botanist in that way. And the other thing that he would have been familiar with and very knowledgeable about was optics and the use of his the camera lucida mirrors to enlarge things or distort or direct light. And those two things sort of came together in the idea of this optical tree. I wanted to do something optical, and then it naturally grew into something which was also quite close to him, was trees. He photographed trees quite a lot as well. I've always been interested how reflection works, and glass does fantastic tricks with reflection. The spheres turn images on this tree, turn images upside down. There's a set of convex and concave mirrors on the tree which magnify and then shrink images as well. And the prisms diffract light. You can see rainbow colors as they split light into the colors. And I thought it would be a magical experience. I was first thinking of children, but I think a lot of grown-ups will really enjoy the playing with the imagery that happens in all the different little aspects of the piece. So I thought it was something I thought would be a really playful, happy thing to have, and it uses all natural light.
Lisa's piece, the green tree out in the garden, has globes. They're sort of apple-like globes hanging from the branches of the tree. If you look through the globe, you see the view behind, which is St. Cyriac's Church in the village. And the first thing you notice is that the church and all the surroundings are upside down and backwards. And that's not an accident, that's exactly how lenses actually see.
The image in the negative window is from a scene that's very close by to the piece. It's taken of an oak tree out across the field. And Talbot took a similar image in the first few years that he developed the photographic process of an oak tree in winter with bare branches. And I was thinking about how his view of the world and how he looked out onto the world was really quite different from almost anybody at that time. He could make mental leaps quite quickly, so when he was looking out his window into nature, he was thinking and seeing very different things than anybody could have foreseen. And the other thing I thought about is how excited he must have been the first time he saw his own negative, that reverse image, the surrealness of it, and how striking it must have been. And that was really exciting, to think that nobody in the world, maybe but him, had ever seen anything like that before. And it's very common now. People do understand it, but it's also starting to disappear because of digital photography. People don't look at negatives anymore. So it'll be a reminder to some people and new information to younger people, perhaps, and maybe that's a good thing.
People who come and see it now then should come back in the spring and see that when it's a carpet of purple crocuses. So I'm hoping it will get people out to see the areas at different times of the year. Maybe they'll revisit them. And you'll get different reflections and patterns from the artworks as the surroundings around them change. So at the moment, all the leaves are on the trees, but in the winter, it'll be quite different. It'll be quite exciting to see how they change with the seasons as well. We're always thinking about Fox Talbot because of the botanical aspect. So it's we want to make it appropriate to his interests and just make it a really delightful place for visitors. I really enjoy working in a public garden because I enjoy meeting the public and talking to them about plants, and I hope to point out something to them that they didn't know and that would give them that sort of special kind of little moment that they'll remember about Lacock.
My name is Andy Hazell. I'm an artist. I live in Mid Wales. I build everything from automata, make short films, and also make large lumps of public art which litter the roundabouts of the nation. The light umbrella is a 5 meter aluminium umbrella inset with prisms, and the idea stemmed from going to the National Museum of Photography, Film and Television in Bradford, which had one of the first photographs ever taken, which was light through trees. And I thought, perfect thing. I always like this idea of sort of sitting around in the sun and staring up, and that sort of timeless summer thing of watching the light dapple through trees. And so that I would try to evoke that. The connection with Fox Talbot is the what some of the first photographs were, simple light impressions by making a photographic plate light sensitive, then placing a leaf upon it, and then recording its sort of nuclear shadow. And so, inspired by this, I created the light umbrella.
Andy Hazell's piece, which is the large carousel, it comes from a story about Aristotle, believe it or not, so it goes back that far. Aristotle noted that when there was a solar eclipse, the light that filtered through trees, dappled trees onto the ground, changed from being round amorphous blobs of light to crescent-shaped blobs of light. And it's because the little gaps between the leaves were acting like miniature lenses that would focus the light down on the ground and give you this look. So Andy's parasol has lots of little holes and openings through the top of it. It won't protect you from the rain, that's for sure. And he's also inserted a number of prism-like devices and things like that. So hopefully on a good sunny day, when the carousel is turning, we'll have rainbows sparkling everywhere and dappled light on the ground.
I hope it's kind of contemplative piece. When I built it, I kind of envisaged this step around the outside where you could sit or lie down and just lie and watch this revolving canopy of leaves and prisms, because it makes little spectrums when the sun shines. It's so much part of my life. I really love photographs. I spend everywhere I go, I carry a camera. And so being in Fox Talbot, this is ground zero for photography. This is great. One of the prime things about National Trust properties is people tend to only follow the path. So it's been put slightly off the main route, and it makes this a bit of an eye catcher. So like a sort of, one of those things that rich gentlemen used to put at the far end of their drive to make people go, oh, look at that over there. I shall go for a gentlemanly stroll and have a look what that is.
Well, I think the Eccleston and George things, I mean, they don't look terribly exciting from a distance, but I think they're really magic because it's a way of getting up close with things and seeing the detail. So our paths, for instance, are made of South Cerny gravel, and in the gravel there are loads of fossils. And if you just spend 5 minutes kind of fishing about in the gravel, find some super fossils, and then you can take them to one of these posts and look at them underneath. And that makes you think about the whole Fox Talbot optics thing again. And because he had collections of shells and fossils, you know, and ranged them out in cabinets, like Victorian people did, they loved to collect things. But you can put a leaf underneath and appreciate the kind of tiny hairs underneath a leaf, or the finer points of a little flower or a bird's feather or something like that. So it's just about making you look again at the natural world.
There are actually 4 of the magnifying posts, and they're set in different areas in the grounds, and that will be an ideal way for people to step back off the path that walks down to the Abbey, which when people come in they see the Abbey and it's an immediate pull to walk straight down there. But there's some lovely areas. We're standing in the rose garden, the tree is in the orchard. One of the magnifying posts is near our lovely willow sculpture that at this time of year is a great one for children to run in and out of and have a bit of an adventure there. So, you know, they followed three different artists, but they connect together and make capturing the light a really live project for Lacock.
What we're trying to do is to convince people that Lacock is one big complex property, and to see it all, you need to see it all. So start out with a bit in the museum and then trail around the grounds. And the artwork is meant to bring the photographic optical elements of the museum out into the gardens, and then the gardens will lead you from there up into the Abbey itself. And hopefully by the time you get into the Abbey, you've experienced something of the story of photography and the idea that Lacock was the home of the invention of photography.
So Lacock is a great place to visit. There's lots of things to do, and we have all this stuff going on in the grounds. When you get down to the Abbey, there's a chance to see the oriel window. In the South Gallery, you'll find some of Fox Talbot's cameras. And back in the museum is the whole story of photography for everyone to have a look at. And finally, take some great photographs. It's a fantastic place for photographs.